Standing, let's turn over a few pages to page number 57. Page number 57, we'll sing all four stanzas of At Calvary. Amen. 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 There's a place called Calvary. I've been there through the pages of God's Word. All right. Well, several announcements to make. Most of these are in the bulletin. Hope you'll pay attention and mark them down, okay? And before I get into the announcements, though, I want to share with you Brother Jim Meyer's mother passed away a couple of days ago, and continue to pray for that family. And they're going to have a memorial service up where she was from, up in Ohio, I think, somewhere, sometime in the future. And so continue to pray for that family, okay? Sure appreciate the Meyer family. All right, let's see here. Not next Sunday, but the week after next Sunday, the 23rd through the 26th, we're going to be in revival services here with Brother Bo Wagner. I'm looking forward to that. I trust that you'll be praying for the services and that you'll have, be here every service, Monday through Thursday night at 7 o'clock each evening. And we'll have some flyers made this week and have them for you, hopefully by Wednesday or next Sunday, to get those things handed out. And then on the 28th of this month, youth meeting over at the St. Stephen, in St. Stephen at Life Baptist Church, and from 2 to 5. And so hope you young folks will be looking forward to going over there. It's always a good meeting at Brother Willis's church. And then on the last Tuesday night, Halloween night really, up at the Tabernacle, we're going to have a children's night out, fun night out for the kids, 12 and under. And alternative to what goes on in the world, we're going to have some games, activities, and contests out here for the kids and win some prizes, have door prizes. We're going to have hot dogs to eat, so that'll be fun. And so hope you'll be out here on that special occasion on the 31st from 6 to 8. And then November the 5th, Homecoming Sunday, the Hoy family will be here. Brother Ron will be preaching. And then also Brother Mark Mitchum will be here. He'll be helping out with the singing. Fine young man. Looking forward to that. Okay. This morning we're going to do something very different. I've never done this before, and I may never do it again, but we're going to do it this morning. We have a little something in the bulletin about Brother Whitman, because the service was held on a Sunday morning up there in Anderson. I think it was maybe a dozen to 15 people were able to be there from this church. And this morning, I am going to, it won't be the identical message. I'm going to preach a message pertaining to what I preached at his funeral. And I'm hoping that this morning I'm going to give you an opportunity to, if you have some a good memory of Brother Whitman, I want you to give it. Now, here's what I want for you to do, okay? We want to present this to Miss Whitman sometime in the next week or so, mail it to her, give it to her, whatever. I'd like for you to come right here in the front, take the microphone, and share with us your memory of Brother Whitman. The reason I want to do that so we can be videoed. We can give you the microphone, but it can only, we want to see the back of your head, okay? So if how many here have a good memory of Brother Whitman? Only one or two, three, four of you, okay? And if you've been here any length of time, if you've never met him, you missed a meeting a good man, okay? And I'm preaching on the exceptional man. He was an exceptional man, okay? And so anyway, we're going to do that this morning. So I hope that you will share your good memory of him as we do that. And then I'm going to preach that message that deals with him, okay? All right. Well, anyway, I think that's all the announcements. You pray and listen as the choir sings.
Oh, that. What a blessing.
Seats. Ready? We ready. Anybody have a birthday? All right. Come on up here, jalapeno lady. Huh? You love jalapeno.
You haven't given me any in a while.
I know. Well, I appreciate you reminding me, but my wife already reminded me too.
What? About the
jalapeno stuff and getting you some. I'm falling down on the job, right?
Yeah. But I only like them from Captain D's.
Only from Captain D's jalapenos. Okay. We'll go up there today, tomorrow, one day, and get you a bucket load full, okay? All right, when was your birthday?
The 13th. Friday.
Friday the 13th.
Yeah, but I'm a lucky Friday.
You're lucky Friday the 13th.
I'm a blessed one, yes. See how blessed? Thank you.
That's a sweet lady, isn't it? Occasionally. Anyway. Yeah. I don't know what we do without her, I know that. Amen. Let's sing happy birthday to her. That money, she's hit the road. Yeah, I don't know what she'll do with that $5, but she'll do something with it. Amen. All right. Well, I need to.
You'd already got this one. Huh? You'd already got this one on, but
already got that one. Okay. All right. We're going to give those of you who'd like to an opportunity to share with us and nothing very lengthy, just as brief as you can make it. About Brother Whitman, and I know he was a prankster sometimes, and I know sometimes he was something else, wasn't he? If you hear long enough, I usually pick up on what you call me. Some members call me Brother Baker, Preacher Baker, and other names as a pest, aggravation, stuff like that. He called me Preacher. I can hear him now. Preacher! I say, oh boy, had that accent. And I mentioned up there, it is a homegoing service. Sometimes he would keep a collection of my words I'd make up, and they had them written down. And so I tell you what, though. All right, so I'd like for you to come, if you've and share with us here at the front, your good memory of Brother Whitman, no matter when it was. Okay, who'll be the first? All right, you be first. Okay.
Got a couple real quick. I did not share these at the funeral, but I'm glad you're giving us an opportunity today. But when we first started coming back here, you know, we grew up here, and then we started coming back 9 years ago. The first time we was able to help out with the camp meeting, you know, of course he was always outside, kind of keeping everything kind of in order. I come by and I didn't know what to do, so I just come right on in, and I started to go in the kitchen, and he said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going in the kitchen." He said, "A little word of advice, don't go in there." He said, "Them women's crazy, don't go in there." And I didn't. And then another time he called me one morning and his truck wouldn't start. He had it parked under the shed, and I went around there and some rats had chewed a bunch of wires. And so I fixed it, got it running for him. I said, "Mr. Whitman," I said, "you need to put something out here for these rats." He said, "Okay, I'll take care of it." So a few weeks later, he needed something else done to it, so he brought it to the shop. Well, he took care of them rats. When I upped that hood, there was green stuff all under that hood. I mean, he put so many rat pellets under there till it wasn't funny. He meant to kill them rats. But it was several. I mean, there's so many, we could be here all day, but I just wanted to share that. But that one with the camp meeting, that was, he said, "Just a little word of advice. Don't go in there. They're crazy."
All right, Brother Tommy, you come right here. Oh, you going to go up there? Go ahead. I'll be fine right there.
Mr. Whitman, once in a while, he called me to do a little something for him. He just cut and coal in the street. And so Mr. Mack passed away, and Mr. Whitman just took over. And that was a blessing to have somebody like that just... He just took in, whatever needed to be done, he'd tell you what to do, and he did so much himself. Kind of like when Miss Betty come, Miss Binkley left, Miss Betty came in, the Lord sent her. So we were just blessed to have Mr. Whitman. So I don't know who would be the next one to take Mr. Whitman's place, but we are still looking to see. A lot of Mr. Whitman, he was a real straight fella. I shouldn't say this, I don't guess, but I said, if we got to have a northern, we couldn't beat you. He was all right.
If we got to have a northerner, we just couldn't beat him. All right. You want to use this one or up there? Okay, here we go.
We were blessed that Mr. Whitman decided to sit on the same pew with us. And when it came handshaking time, I didn't know that he'd been a dairy farmer. And the first few times he'd shake my hand, he like crushed it. So it got to the point, as soon as they'd say shake hands, I tried to go across the aisle to get away from Mr. Whitman because he literally hurt my hand. But Mr. Mack was still here at the beginning, and Mr. Mack would reach across a pew, and he almost flipped me one day because he pulled so hard. But it was a real blessing. My husband became great friends with him, and they would swap books and stories. And my husband used to say that when he grew up, he wanted to be like Mr. Whitman.
Me too. All right, Nancy.
Whenever Mr. and Miss Whitman came to our church, it was like you had always known them. They were easy to love, and they just got right in the church. They didn't skip a beat. They said, "What can we do?" I know Miss Charlene, she ended up as being the secretary there for a while and was a blessing, but Brother Whitman with the camp meeting, I don't know what we would have done without him. I don't care what I called and asked him, or I said, you know, I need help with this, we need this done. He never skipped a beat. He was always willing to do, and such a blessing and such a joy. He had that dry wit about him, always looked forward to his little jokes and his stories. But he'll always be in my heart, and Miss Charlene too.
You're talking about he was a charge guy. Very somebody ever come to me and say, "Preacher, here's what I think we should do." He'd say, "Preacher, here's what we're going to do." I said, "Oh, really?" He said, "Well, yeah." I said, "Who decided that?" He said, "Well, basically me." It always had to do with something around the church, though, wasn't it? And on a few occasions, there'd be a couple of times I said, "Nah, we can't do that right now." He never asked why. He'd say, "Okay." But very seldom that happened, because usually whatever he wanted to do, it needed to be done. And so that's good. All right, somebody else? Someone else have one? Okay, Rick.
When we first came here, we sat on this side. Then they moved the piano and the organ, so we sat on this side. But when you sat in Whitman's corner over here, you people missed out on a lot of the little sayings he threw up, like if the pastor said, "This is my seventh and last point, I'm almost done," and you hear this chuckle behind you as Mr. Whitman would make a comment. And I think we were always safe over here because, you know, Mrs. Whitman had her concealed weapons carry permit. She'd wear pocketbooks out where the barrel would wear through the bottom of the pocketbook. So she goes, I got a new pocketbook today. And I told my wife, if anything bad ever happens, just duck down in the pew, because we've got Mr. and Mrs. Whitman behind us.
Yeah, this was Whitman's corner, all right. He would say things, I'm almost through. He's, yeah, we've heard that before. Anyone else, Denny? Huh? All right.
I had a pretty close relationship with Mr. Whitman. I'm not going to replow the ground that I talked about at the funeral. Instead, I just wanted to comment that my oldest daughter, Christy, when she heard that he had died, that she shared a memory of him. And that was how much he loved his horse. That he took care of that horse when it was ancient. The horse was about blind, could barely stand up, and he still loved that old horse. And when the horse really couldn't see anymore, Mr. Whitman would go out to the fence and what the horse loved were these little peppermints, the same ones he was always giving the kids. And that all he had to do was to rattle the little wrapper, and the horse would hear that and would come to him. And the kids in church were kind of the same way, that all he had to do is stick his hand in a pocket and there'd be a flock of kids around him because they knew that there was mints coming out of the pocket. So, I remember the fastest way to make him happy was to give him a book, and the fastest way to get on his nerves was to give his wife another set of salt and pepper shakers.
I probably got a half a dozen books in my office that he gave me. Good boy. He gave me one on the history of the United States. And he said, I want you to read that book. It's a good book. Well, it was about this thick. I said, it'll take me a year to read it. He said, I don't want no preaching from it either if it's that thick. Anyone else? Oh, okay.
I have been the church secretary for several years, but they were remodeling the church at one time down in the Sunday school area. And Mr. Whitman and Joe Ben and Sam were a dynamic demolition team. Every time I turned around, one more wall was gone, and there was dust everywhere. Anyway, you might find power at one time, and then I'd be typing away thinking I was almost finished with my work, and all of a sudden the power was gone, and I hadn't saved it, so I'd have to do it all again, you know, things like that. But one day, I decided I would go down the hallway and went into the ladies' room, and when I got to the mirror, I went, I was totally gray because of all the dust I had to go through. Gray hair, gray eyes, gray face, everything. I was in shock when I looked in that mirror. Like I say, they literally tore the whole building up, but it looks good now.
All right. Anyone else? All right. I'm Sister Pam. Oh, I bet there's something here now.
Apparently, I'm the only one he abused. I would sit in my pew, and he would come by and knock cool out of my shoulder every time he came by. And then he would just look at me like, you know, and give me that, why are you even here, look. And then he would ask Andy, when Andy was still here, he'd say, is she the best you can do? And but anyway, I loved him to death, and Miss Whitman, and love you, Miss Whitman.
Amen. Yeah, he was character now. Uh-huh. One time we preached, and he'd on the way out, he'd always say a little something about the message. He said, boy, I love that first 20 minutes. Boy, I love that first 20 minutes. Every once in a while, he might say, boy, I was glad that was a good sermon at the end, preacher. Just little things like that. Anybody else? Yeah.
I brought this up at the funeral, but he was always making fun of the way I talked. I don't really know why, but he just said I was just too Southern. And it just got on his nerves sometimes, the way I talked. So he gave me a book, too. The Boston Dictionary, he said, and I would expect you to read this and try to talk. But, you know, when they got ready, when they were going to move, I was so emotional about that. And I knew we were going to have something for them. And so I was working then, so I stopped by their house and I told them, I said, I'm coming by today to say goodbye. I said, because I just cannot do it at the church. And I just cried. And I said, now, when you do leave, I'll just wave or something. I said, because I just can't bear to tell you bye. But I would always call them frequently, but it never failed. When I called and talked, I would cry and cry. And he'd say, stop that sniffling. Stop that crying. I don't want you to do that. And I said, I can't help it. I just love them so much. But Miss Whitman, I've been calling and checking on her, and she seems to be doing well, but just pray for her.
Yeah, no sniveling. No sniveling. That's what he'd say. Anyone else? Okay. All right. That's it? All right. Give you one last chance. I asked him one time, I said to Brother Whitman, I said, why don't you and I sing a special one of these days? He said, well, preacher, I've heard you sing, you've heard me sing, we better just leave it like it is. And you stick to preaching, and I, and he would always come. I remember one time Sister Brenda's well, W-E-L-L, had gone dry. So we were going to see about putting her new well down. But he got home and he told, or after church, he looked at his wife, he said, why would we want to put down a well for a widow in the church? What are they going to do with a well? He thought I was using, talking about a whale in the ocean instead of a whale. And, of course, when you call their house, their answering machine, hello, this is the Whitman farm. And she said, she would say to me, she called me Brother Baker. He called me Preacher. Brother Baker, we got us another car. You know what a car is? Huh? And then the weather up where they moved from, it snowed all the time. As his house one day, and he said, I'm going to show you a picture, Preacher, show me a picture. He said, you see that little thing sticking up right there? I said, yeah, I see that. He said, that's the antenna of the truck. Couldn't even see the truck. All you see is about 6 inches of the antenna sticking up. Truck completely covered in snow. And so he tried his best to get Miss Baker to go up there for a while, but she was not going to cold weather. All right. Well, okay, that's it. So we're going to stand right now and sing a song and receive this morning's tithes and offerings, okay?
Let's all stand, turn to page number 65. Page number 65, we'll sing the first and last stanza of Near the Cross. Amen. Let's all stand.
Jim Meyer, and were you the other usher, or it might have been Raymond? But I think that day, I think we had either three or four Yankees ushers, and I made mention of that. Here we are in Southern State, fixed taking off from the church, and we got four Yankees. I might have been three, but Brother Whitman was on the end over here. And when I said that, he said the offerings have been pretty good, hadn't the preacher? I said, yeah. He said, because we take an offering. Amen. I wrote this about Brother Whitman. I'm going to preach this message this morning. Ralph Whitman, the exceptional man. There's a real famine in our land. This famine I speak of has to do with the exceptional man. A man found not just anywhere, but a man filled with honesty and integrity in his life to share. A man named Whitman comes to mind. Look around all you want, and you will find he's one of a kind. Old Ralph was a bold man with a lot of grit. Men like him helped build our land. This rugged dairy farmer was a balanced man, fiery at time when necessary, yet gentle enough to hold a child's hand. This exceptional man was a take-charge guy. Give him a job to do, they consider it done without a what, where, or why. Faithfulness marked this man of character, true to his wife all his days. Mess with his Charlene, then get ready to meet your maker. This exceptional man moved from the north to the south. Took us a while to understand some of the words out of his mouth. God and country lived in this man's heart. He expected every citizen to do their part. To the Patriots, to the Red Sox, he was a diehard fan. Just another virtue of this exceptional man. They say that a dog is a man's best friend. Old Brewski was that to Ralph's very end. This exceptional man has now graduated to glory. With body frail and weak, he left us, but that is not the end of his story. He will live on in each of us who knew him well, this exceptional man who lived a life worthy to tell. Amen. We all need to be exceptional men, you know that? All right, let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for helping us today. Once again, we thank you for our good friend who's with you now, Brother Whitman, and there he's joined the saints of God that have gone on to glory over the years. We've had many here. Now they're gathered in the glory. And Lord, one day we'll see them again. We'll meet them. But Lord, most of all, we'll see you. What a day that's going to be when we look up on your face and realize it's all made possible because of what you've done for us, Lord Jesus. Now bless the offering as we receive it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. good, Miss Betty. Praise the Lord for that. Let's get our Bibles out this morning. Turn to the book of Ezekiel in chapter number 22. Ezekiel chapter 22, as you turn there. And I consider it a great honor that we could say these things today about this gentleman we call Ralph Whitman. But if he were here, he would not want that at all possible. He'd want us to talk about the Lord. And But I believe the Lord would have us that to do what we've done today. I'm going to read some scripture out of the book of Ezekiel that describes our land today, America, in great detail. Even though the Lord is speaking to through Ezekiel, he's speaking about Israel. Israel had gotten away from God. They had abandoned his word. They had gone their own way. And so God is dealing with that now in these verses. As we read these verses, I cannot help but think about America and what's going on today. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse number 23. Ezekiel 22, 23. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto her, now that her there is Israel, Thou art the land that is not cleansed, nor rained upon in the day of indignation. There is a conspiracy of her prophets in the midst thereof, like a roaring lion raving the prey. They have devoured souls. They have taken the treasure and precious things. They have made her many widows in the midst thereof. Her priest have violated my law, have profaned my holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and profane. Neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean. And have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths. And I am profaned among them. Does that not sound like America? Huh? Okay. It says, now that has to do with the spiritual leadership of Israel. This would be, we would say that about preachers today. Never have I seen a day in our land that has to where churches and supposedly God's people have put no difference between the clean, the unclean, the profane and stuff like that. Today it's almost like you can live like you want to and go to church and feel right at home. Don't mess with sin. Don't mess with evil things. Just make me feel good, preacher. Give me a service where I can walk out saying, "Boy, this is great." But I'm gonna tell you what: when our nation is going the way it's going, and preachers no longer preach from the Word of God, we're in trouble. Now I'm not. Listen, we've always had acts of nature. We call it. We've always had hurricanes and floods and things like that. But never have I seen in my lifetime what we've seen today happen to America with its acts of nature. The fires of California, over a quarter million people has been evacuated. Wineries burnt down, which I'm glad. I wish all the wineries would burn down. Amen. Not loss of life, but loss of that mess. And then we see the devastation in the Gulf Coast and Florida and all over the place, even up north. And I cannot help but say, I think it's the hand of God. Amen. Amen. And it says here, verse 27, now he's talking about her princes in the midst thereof are like wolves raving the prey. Now this is government, to shed blood and to destroy souls, to get dishonest gain. Does that not sound like politics? And her prophets, listen now, her prophets have dabbed them with untempered mortar. And that word dab means, you know, this patched up, okay? Seeing vanity and divining lies unto them, saying, Thus saith the Lord God, when the Lord hath not spoken. You ever heard people say, well, the Lord spoke to me, and he ain't spoke to them. And it says, the people of the land have used oppression and exercised robbery and have vexed the poor and needy. Yea, they have oppressed the stranger wrongfully. And notice verse 30 is my verse I want you to look at.
And I sought for a man among them who should take up, who should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me in the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. I sought for a man to make up the hedge, stand in the gap, but I found none. Therefore have I poured out mine indignation upon them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. Their own way have I recompensed upon their heads, saith the Lord. What God is saying there in that last verse, God says, now they've sown this, here's what they're going to reap. And so God said, I'm sought for a man that would make up the hedge and stand in the gap for the land. When I think about that type of man, I thought about Brother Whitman, but we're going to just drop him right now because I think we have given him due honor that even he wouldn't want us to do that, but I think it was good to do it. But this morning, I want to take this thought about the exceptional man and preach it this morning to those of us who are here. Now, when I use the word man, that's masculine, but I want you ladies to listen very carefully too, and you young girls who are here. In the day in which we live, every young lady ought to look for a husband that God would have for her. And that young lady, if she's saved, ought to look for an exceptional young man. Amen. Now, for him to be an exceptional young man, that means his father is going to have to be an exceptional father. Amen. And so the exceptional man, we have a shortage today of manhood in America. You know that? Now, when we think about manhood, when I use manhood, I'm not talking about the physique of a man. He may have big bulging muscles, he may have pearly white teeth and be as handsome as a fella could be, but that does not make him a man. A manhood is not a man who can cuss every time he makes a sentence, okay? A manhood is not a man who'll go around trying to show that he can beat somebody up, how much beer and liquor he can drink, and how many tattoos he can put on his body. That is no, matter of fact, that's not manhood at all. That's foolishness. That's the foolish man. And for 16 years, we've had no real man in the White House. We had Clinton, we had Obama, we had no man in the White House. This present president, though, seems to want to turn America around, okay? Now, we don't know how it's going to turn out. He's trying to do that. Now, I'm not saying that our president is an exceptional man. I'm saying he's trying to turn our country around, and I'll just leave it at that, okay? But the Bible does give us some examples of exceptional men, men who rose to the occasion of that day and time. For example, Noah was an exceptional man. God comes to Noah and says, Noah, I've seen what's going on. He said, it's evil before my eyes. I am going to destroy the whole world and every living creature on the earth. I want you to build me an ark. And so by faith, Noah built that ark. That would take an exceptional man. Amen. I thought about this. Abraham was an exceptional man. Now, when I use the word exceptional, I'm not talking about that they were perfect. Every man that we'll mention in the Bible had flaws about them except Jesus himself. So Abraham, God comes to Abraham. He's a wealthy man. He's got great herds. He's got servants. And God comes to him and says, Abraham, I want you to gather everything up. I'm going to take you to a land I'm going to give you. And Abraham said, Lord, where is that land? He said, I'm not going to tell you. Just follow me. So Abraham packed everything up and said, God, wherever you go, I'll follow. That's an exceptional man. I thought about Joseph was an exceptional man. At 17 years old, he was betrayed by his brothers, thrown in a pit. And for 13 years, he went through all kinds of situations. Joseph was an exceptional man. Amen. I thought about this. Moses was an exceptional man. Oh my, we could talk all day about Moses. Joshua was an exceptional man. I thought about Gideon was just a plain old farmer, but God took him and used him to be a great judge of Israel. David was an exceptional man. Matter of fact, as a young man, the Bible tells us that David was a man after God's own heart. He rose to the occasion. He arrives at the camp of Israel to bring food to his brothers for the battle. And there Goliath comes out, curses the God of Israel. And David said, is there not a cause? And David ended up killing that giant. Would you call that an exceptional man? I would. John the Baptist. What an exceptional man John was. Matter of fact, he was so exceptional that Jesus said, of all the men ever born of woman, of all the men born. Now, he's included Noah, Moses, and all the Old Testament people. He's including a whole bunch. But Jesus says the greatest man ever born of woman was John the Baptist. Exceptional man, John the Baptist. And then, of course, we cannot leave out the Apostle Paul. We cannot leave out Peter and the apostles. But none of these were more exceptional than Jesus Christ himself. Amen? Because he, even though he was man, he was no ordinary man. He was the God-man. Amen? And so Jesus was the perfect man. And so God is looking for a man today. He's looking for a man that lives by principle, that lives by the statutes of God. One who will make a difference, not for himself, but for others. Boy, when I look today and I hear and I read the paper about these multi-million dollar athletes who call themselves men, who say, well, I'm not going to stand for the national anthem because I believe there's oppression in America. I'm not going to stand. I'm not going to give allegiance to the flag because of the oppression of the black man and other minorities in America. And here's a man who's a multi-millionaire, who will take the exception, great day alive. And so God's looking for a man today, a man who will rise to the occasion. Doesn't have to be an educated man. Doesn't have to be a real smart man. Doesn't have to be a man of great stature. Just a man who will say, God, here I am and use me. Now, for this man that God's looking for, I want to share with you a few things. And I believe that Brother Whitman had some of these virtues in his life. And I want you men to, just, I want to challenge you, you men here and you young men here. To be an exceptional man, you got to have a love for God. Let me say it again. To be the exceptional man that will make up the hedge and stand in the gap, you're going to have a love for God. You know what's missing today in manhood? No love for the Lord. We live in a day and time where most people live unto themselves, for themselves and unto themselves. Now, if they've accumulated stuff, if they have stuff piled up, and they will take from their abundance and help people out. But the exceptional man loves like God loves because they love the Lord. I think about men today and men who will say, I love the Lord. They have faith in their God. And they don't cower down to the world. They have faith in God. My God can help me. My God can do anything. My God is there's no God like my God. I love my God. And my God's name is Jesus Christ. The exceptional man has a love for Jesus Christ, the one and only God. He's not a one of many gods. He is the only God. And the exceptional man says, my God's name is Jesus Christ, and I'm not ashamed of it. I'm proud to be his follower. That's the exceptional man. Amen. It may cost you your job. It may cost you a promotion. It may cost you. But the exceptional man says, I'm not ashamed to be called a Christian. Amen. Amen. Wow. And so he loves the Lord. A love that has devotion. A love that says, I'm going to spend time each day with the one that I love. I'm gonna pray and get along with him and believe what he says and trust him and have some time with him. I'm gonna open up the Bible and I'm gonna see what my God has to say to me today. In other words, this exceptional man makes much of the Word of God. Are you listening to me? And I don't know, as I look out in the congregation this morning, I wonder how many here you've read your Bible every day this week. You say, well, I love the Lord, Brother Baker. He's been so good to me. When's the last time you really talked to him? When's the last time you got into a quiet place and said, God, I love you, and Lord, speak to my heart. Show me something, and get the Bible out and read the Word of God. When's the last time you've done that? I went over and visited, was it yesterday or Friday? I went to see Ned at the soup place. Friday. I went to the Super Bad Men's store. He's going to be moving this week and going up to Spartanburg. So I went by and I had some gifts for him. Now, he's not saved. Okay? And I've been talking to him for years and years and years. So I went by. I said, I got something for your wife and I got something for you. I got you a book here. And so I said, this book will really help you. It has to do with business. And it's a Christian book. And then I got him a Bible. And I put in there, to my good friend Ned. And I was thanking him for the kindness he's shown to me over the years. Amen. And he calls me Pastor Baker. Pastor Baker, he said, nobody's ever given me nothing. Here's my point. I said, Ned, this is a good book here. It'll help you if you read it. It'll help you with your business. But Ned, this is the most important book you'll ever own, is a Bible. I said, now this has got some study notes in it. It'll help you understand some of the Bible. Do you have a Bible? He said, this is the first Bible I've ever had. And so I said, would you promise me that you'll read this when you can? He said, I'll read the Bible. I said, here's what I want you to read. I said, don't worry about some of this. Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I'm telling you, if you read, because that's what my preacher told me when I first got saved. A love for God. He'll read his Bible. Have you read your Bible this week? He prays and studies the Word of God. He's a separated man. When I use the word separated, he's separated unto the Lord. He's consecrated unto God. This exceptional man loves the Lord. And though he may have a vocation, that vocation does not take the place of his devotion to the Lord. Sometimes there'll be men who will allow their business or allow their vocation to stand in the way of God. I appreciate the owners of Chick-fil-A, don't you? Don't you appreciate them? They don't open on Sunday. I would call that an exceptional man, wouldn't you? Don't even know the guy. I would call that an exceptional man who will say, I don't care about the millions of dollars that I could make. I'm not going to open up on the Lord's Day. He didn't say Sunday. He said the Lord's Day. In other words, to him, Sunday is the Lord's Day. Amen? I got news for you. The exceptional man says every day is the Lord's Day. Every day is the Lord's Day because Jesus is the Lord of every day. Amen? So the exceptional man, if he's going to really do anything, he's going to have a love for God. He loves the church he's a member of. And by the way, he's a member of it. He's devoted to that place called church. He's devoted to that crowd of people, or that congregation, whether it be a congregation of 50 or 5,000. He's a part of that local congregation. He attends each and every service unless he's sick or providentially hindered. He comes to revival. He prays for it. He supports it financially. Preacher, what can I do? He's there to help out. He's there to get it. I'm telling you, when Brother Whitman came here, he said, Preacher, I want to get busy. I want to do something. And he did. Amen. He loved it. You know what bothers me about men who say they love God, love the church? They look forward not to being in church. If you look forward to not being in church, then you're not an exceptional man. Now, there's times you cannot be in church. I understand that. But when you look forward to it, oh my, that ought to tell you something right there. Number two, he had a love for God. has a love for his family. Amen. Poor Brother Whitman loved his family. And the reason that he's actually moved from here up there was because of his family. His family said, "Dad, we want to take care of you and Mom, and we're up here. Could you move up here? It'd be a lot easier for you to move than to us to move. Get up here so we can be, you ain't got to live with us, but close by so we can take care of you the best we can." So Brother Whitman came to me, he and Miss Whitman came to me and said, "Preacher," said, "you know, my health is not that good now, nor is hers. And that place we live out there, it's real demanding now. I can't keep up with it," stuff like that. He said, "And our children and our grandkids want us to move closer to them. What do you think about it?" I said, "You ought to pack up and move." "Man," he said, "wow." He said, "That's pretty quick." And I said, "No, Brother Whitman, I wish you could stay here. But if you want your kids, if your kids want to take care of you, you better go. Because that's rare today." Amen. And they've done a good job of it too. But he loved his family. This exceptional man loves his family. He's a devoted husband. I said he's a devoted husband. I mean, his wife is the apple of his eye. Other than the Lord Jesus Christ himself, there's nobody else like her. I mean, she's the queen. And she has a beauty about her that he sees and nobody else may see. She has a way about her that nobody else has. Now we married men, we have wives, amen. Hey, anybody here got a perfect wife? Oh, I better not ask somebody to stand up, show us the world. There's not a perfect wife here, amen. Neither is there a perfect husband here, but I'm telling you, hey, that exceptional man looks at her. It doesn't matter what the years have done to him or her. To him, she is still the beauty queen that he married. Amen. Miss Baker and I, we go off somewhere. We'll go out somewhere. We'll go to eat, and we'll sit down, and they'll say, "Where y'all from?" We'll say, "We're from Walterboro, South Carolina." And I say, "I'm James Baker, and this is my bride, Sherry." When I use the word bride, you know what they think? "Well, y'all just got married." "No, we've been married 150 years now." She's still my bride. Listen, this exceptional man loves his family. She does not have to even doubt how much he loves her. There's trust is there. Amen. In other words, he has given himself to her. Like Christ gave himself to church. And so he loves his wife. He's a devoted husband to her. She knows that. That he meant his marriage vows. There's no other woman other that he has an eye for than her. And then not only is he a devoted husband, he's a diligent father. I say diligent father, this exceptional man. In other words, There's a connection with he and his children that only God can put together. And that connection is a spiritual connection to where he's trying to set the example of a godly father, trying to set the example of a leader in the home that his son can look up to spiritually, that his daughters can look up to and say, "Boy, my daddy is such a devout man that the young man that I want my life, I want him to have some of what my daddy's got." All right, listen to me. The exceptional man has virtues about him that his children say, "Wow, the exceptional man." Now, what we got today, think about that. What do we have today? You young ladies here, listen to Brother Baker. When it comes time for you to date into court, whatever you want to call it, that young man, where does he stand spiritually? Does he measure up to your father's approval? This exceptional man has a love for his children. They know it. He loves them. And sometimes even this exceptional father loves them so much that on occasion when needed and necessary, he has to give them a spanking. He doesn't love that, but it has to be done sometimes. I have a note in my office that my oldest boy wrote when he was about, I don't know, 9 or 10. It's on Father's Day. To Daddy. And it said something like this. I love you. He said, I love you even though you give me spankings. I love you. I thought, boy, that's good there. I don't know if he meant it, but he said it. He said, listen, he is an honorable man. He is a leader, this man, this exceptional man. He loves God, love for his family. Then thirdly, this exceptional man has a love for his country. Amen. Has a love for his country. Has a love for his God, Jesus Christ. Has a love for his family. That's his wife, his children, his mom and dad. He has a love. And so he has a love for his country. He's a faithful citizen. Amen. I'm glad we have men in this church who I consider patriots, men who love our country. Some of you have served in the military and you volunteered. But I remember when I was a little boy, they had to draft in. When you got a certain age, if you didn't go to college, they drafted you. And Brother Baker, did you sign up or did you get volunteered? I volunteered, amen. But I'm thankful that Brother Whitman loved his country. And boy, he was involved in it too. He's a faithful citizen. Now watch this now. This love of country means that this exceptional man was a hard worker in his country. Now, Brother Whitman was a hard worker. I asked him one time, I said, Brother Whitman, I said, on that dairy farm, did you ever get a vacation? He said, no. He said, the closest we get to that, because when you have cows on your dairy farm and you got to do it like this, you can't take a vacation unless you got somebody who knows how to do it, even if you got machines to hook up to them. He said, a vacation might be 2 days for us. And that's because our neighbors would come in and we'd help each other out. In other words, you know what he was saying? He didn't know what a vacation was until he retired. The exceptional man is a hard worker. Hard worker. Well, if there's one thing I'm glad that my grandfather and even my brother-in-law instilled in me was to work. The exceptional man loves his country. He doesn't hold his hand out and say, Uncle Sam, fill my hand up. Now I'm not against some of the programs our country has for poor people, but I'm telling the exceptional man says, give me some work to do. Give me some work to do. I don't want to get on a program to where I got to live by the handouts of the government, other people. He has a love for work. He loves his country. He's a visionary man. In other words, he sees a future. And though I don't know how much, and it was none of my business, here was a man who owned a dairy farm. Now, can you imagine owning a dairy farm and you and your wife and a few others having to run that thing year after year after year after year? But when it come time for him to that retirement days come, he couldn't do it, and he sold his place. He had earned enough in that to where he could what? He could what we call retire. A visionary. In other words, there's going to come a day in my life to where I won't be able to do this now. I better have a vision for the future. Wow. And so the exceptional man has a vision. And here's what I'm going to aim for. Here's what I'm going to strive for. You know what David said? He said, I'm an old man now. And I was young once, but I'm an old man now. And here's what he said. He said, I've never seen the righteous begging. He said, I've never seen the righteous begging. You know what the word righteous means? Right with God. David said, I've never seen anybody who's right with God begging. Why? Because this man who loves the Lord, loves his family, loves his country, is a visionary. He looks and says, you know what? There's opportunities everywhere. Just get busy. My grandfather, third grade education, I think, third grade education, had to drop out of school to take care of the house. My grandfather worked in the cotton mill. Yeah. He had different jobs in the cotton mill, carried his lunch, a lunch box, a little black box, had a thermos in it, and that's what he carried. That was his lunch box. Inside that lunch box was a little New Testament, or a New Testament. And at break time, he'd read his Bible and eat his lunch. Huh? And of course, when my grandfather passed away, we didn't, I don't know. We would call them poor people, but I don't call them poor. His house was paid for because he built it. He and my daddy and his two sons built it. He's a visionary. It's a four-room house, a kitchen, two-bedroom, living room. It had a back porch and side porch. He put them on himself. He had an outhouse until I was about 6 or 7 years old. And when they put the bathroom on the back porch, son, he thought country didn't come to town. Oh, yeah. He did the house with a wood stove. Are you listening to me? Time went on. My granddaddy died. So I go to see my granny, and we're concerned about her, you know, about taking care of her. And we're talking about he loved his country. My granddaddy fought in World War I. And so I said, Granny, what's granddaddy got in that chest for you? He said, well, we got this and that. And so he was putting money in the bank. And so when I went to the bank to see how much was in the bank for my grandmother, I said, wow. I come back and I said, Granny, you're okay, girl. She said, well, I don't know how to spend it. So I'm going to teach you how to write a check. So the first check is to me. No. So I taught her how to write a check. She'd never written a check in her life. My granddaddy saw to it that my grandmother was always taken care of. And when he passed away, he left a nice, attractive house and yard to my grandmother, completely paid for, with money in the bank to see her through the years, working in a cotton mill. Now, he never owned an automobile. I never knew him to go on a vacation. My grandparents lived 45 miles from Columbia, and they may have been there, may have went there maybe five times in his whole lifetime. He said, the furthest I ever traveled was World War I when I fought in the war. Why am I telling you this? He was an exceptional man. Oh, listen. The exceptional man. The exceptional man, he does not look for a fight, but will not back down when threatened. Amen? Has a balanced life. He knows how to be bold, and he knows how to be calm. He must be a compassionate man, not a whiner. Brother Whitman, that whining part. Nothing's worse than to hear a man whine. Whine, whine, whine. We don't get much of them anymore, but we used to get a lot of phone calls from folks out on the interstate. And it was always the wife. I'd say, hello, Welch Creek Baptist Church. Is the Reverend there? I said, this is Brother Baker. Sir, we're out here on the interstate and our cars broke down and we need some help. Think you could help us? I said, well, is your husband with you? Yes, sir. Let me talk to him. And 9 times out of 10, I'd hear him say, hang up. Because he didn't want to talk. He wanted his wife to do the begging. And finally, if he got on the phone, I'd say to him, where are you headed? Well, we were in Florida, headed to New York. Okay, and you got this far? What happened? He said, well, we broke down. I said, so you left Florida, headed to New York, and got no money. That don't sound too smart to me. And I said, well, maybe we can help you out a little bit. We can't fix your car for you, but we can help you out. We'll maybe give you a motel room or something like that. The point I'm making was 9 times out of 10, the man would get his wife to beg. Wow. If there's going to be any begging going on, I ought to do it myself. Are you listening to me? Real men know how to treat a lady. How about that? Amen? Hey, real men don't say, hey, babe. No. Hey, sugar pie. No, that's my sugar pie right there. Are you listening to Brother Baker? He knows how to treat a lady. Listen, real men, they strive to raise their sons and daughters to be godly men and women, for him to be masculine, for her to be feminine. Real men rise to the occasion. They don't hunker down. They rise to the case. Hey, I'm a child of God. With God's help, I can do this. With God's help, I can make it. Real men keep their word. Amen. If they cannot keep their word, they go and explain why. We need more men who will make up the hedge and stand in the gap. America, I'm telling you what. If men would rise to the occasion in America, I'm telling you what, we could turn this country around. If preachers would get up and preach the word of God instead of dibble dabble, preach the word of God, get saved or you're going to hell. Get born again or you're going to die in your sins. I'm telling you, we need some laid back, fiery preaching. Amen. I don't hear that today. We hear today, you're so sweet and so good. Everybody's perfect. No. We're all a bunch of sinners who need help every day. Amen. Amen. Oh, we all need the grace of God every day. I see my imperfections. The more I see him and look at that Bible, the more I see how filthy I really am. Do you know this? I put this in the bulletin last week. There's nothing about your flesh. Everything about you fleshly hates God. Your flesh don't like coming to church. Say amen. Amen. Say amen. Amen. Your flesh don't like reading that Bible. Amen. I said your flesh don't like praying. Your flesh would rather be home now sitting up eating breakfast. Huh? That's your flesh. That's my flesh. But you know what you have to do as a child of God? You have to bring it in subjection. Because your flesh hates everything spiritual. Paul talked about that. But the exceptional man knows how to bring his flesh in subjection. Paul said, I buffet myself. You know what it means? I bring it under control. Get that flesh under control. Because your flesh don't like anything spiritual. Your flesh don't like reading that Bible. The exceptional man has a love for God, a love for his family, a love for his country. He'll make a hedge and be the gap, fill the gap, and be the man of God. Amen. We need some exceptional men today and some exceptional ladies. All right, let's pray. Lord, we've tried to cover a lot of ground this morning. Thank you for men like Brother Whitman. Not a perfect man by no means. He'd be the first to admit he had so many flaws about him and so many shortcomings. And I can remember times, dear Lord, where he would leave and say, preacher, I needed that today. Time and time again, say, preacher, he's right on mark today. I remember times, Lord Jesus, he'd say, you must have been living in my house this week. No, that's just a spiritual man. Being attuned to the Spirit of God in church. So Lord, give us some men today who'll be exceptional. Men who will rise to the occasion, not throw up their hands in despair, but believe in the God that they love and serve him as best they can. Please, God, I want to be an exceptional man. And Lord, I pray you'll give us some more men who will say the same thing. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Stand on our feet. The exceptional man. Every family needs one. Every wife needs one. Every son and daughter needs an exceptional man in their life. Manhood's not just lifting barbells and riding motorcycles. Real manhood is sitting in church with your wife and kids, honoring God serving the Lord. Real manhood is not being bossy and pushy, but being bold and yet gentle. He has an eye for the future. He looks down the road with the help of God, prepares and plans. He learns to live one day at a time. Real man. Not afraid of work, not afraid to sweat. Not afraid of the giants in his life, because he knows his God's a giant killer. The exceptional man. Well, it's been a good morning, hasn't it? I thank you for participating today, those of you who shared a little thing about Brother Whitman, and we'll try to get this thing, get it recorded and ship her a copy of it, and it'll be a blessing to her. But I'm glad that God loves us. Amen? All right. Church at 6:30 tonight, Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Hope you'll be here. All right. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Brother Rick, would you dismiss us, my friend? Well, he's gone.